it's good to have you here nonetheless. So announcements. Elizabeth, I got a letter, Tig and I got a letter from Marion Brown this week, and Elizabeth spoke to Marion Brown, and she would really like people to write to her. She's in Loretta. You all should have a little insert. Elizabeth passed it out, and it's got her address, and if you feel like dropping her a card or a note, that would be great. But just let her know you're thinking of her. Operation Christmas Child, Elizabeth and Val got, they got boxes for this year.
Yeah, and everything came in finally, the stickers, the everything.
They have everything. If you haven't gotten a box yet and you want one, get one. And Val, she thinks she saw the Price is Right. But just sign up so they can keep track of who's got boxes. Hopefully on September 8th, at 6:30 in the evening, we're going to start a Bible study. I don't know what we're going to do yet. It'll be here at the church, and we're going to try to do it on Zoom also, because I know Laura had asked if she'd like to be part of it, but obviously she's down in Margaretville, so we'll see what we can do with that. A week from this Thursday, I think that is the 10th, I'd like to have a board meeting, a brief one, just to go over where we're standing and what's going on, so specifically with the situation with both houses. I do have another, it's an announcement. I was going to save it for praise, but I'll share it now. Most of you know that Tish and I went down to Long Island this week, and we got to visit my friend Charlie that you've all been praying for. Well, we got to visit with him, and he's holding his own. He's holding his own. Tish and I started praying differently. We're not praying for comfort for him now, although we pray for that. What we're praying for is healing. So I would encourage you to pray for healing for Charlie. But we got home on Thursday. I picked up the mail Thursday, rather, and it was a card from Charlie and his wife. And it was dated, it was addressed to me, but it's actually to the whole church. It says, "Dear Jim, Charlie and I want to make a donation to Christ Chapel Church in appreciation for all the prayers and all the thoughts for you and for Charlie and I. And thank you, love from Charlie and Claire." They sent a generous gift, and it's put it in the offering plate, but, you know, they didn't have to do that. It was not expected, but it's just wanted to know that they appreciate all the prayers. And we're not the only church. The church in Cortland is praying for him. I think there's at least three other churches. Charlie is always happy to tell me he's on so many different prayer chains. And he always tells me it must be working. So please continue to pray for Charlie. Any other announcements?
I didn't hear. What time will the meeting be a week from
Thursday? I'm sorry?
What time will the meeting be a week from Thursday?
For the Bible study or the meeting?
The meeting.
6:30. Let's shoot for 6:30. Okay. So let's just start with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for this time we can be together. I thank you for the people who are here, Lord. I ask that you bless our time, bless our fellowship. Father, may everything that we say and do bring glory to you and help us to draw closer to you. I ask in Christ's name. Amen. I think Val has songs for us. We'll find out. The first one is kind of meditative. If you're going to sing, please leave your mask on. If you're not going to sing, you don't have to leave your mask on. Once you're seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
two really great songs, El Shaddai, the all-sufficient one, and My Father's World. Great place to be in is God's world, isn't it? Some praises and prayer requests. Praises. I already said I spoke to Charlie this week. Obviously, we saw him. We had a great visit. We actually saw him twice. I also spoke to Jeff Rhea the other day. Jeff's been calling me to give me updates occasionally on his health, and they put him on a new medication. He's hoping that that'll do it. The doctor said she still has a couple more things up her sleeve that she wants to try before they do anything drastic. But please pray for him. You all know Jeff. He always seems upbeat. It's a pleasure to talk to him. So just keep Jeff in your prayers. Prayer, obviously, my friend Charlie and his wife Claire. Lisa Duvall had a prayer request. I think it was her cousin that was having gallbladder surgery this week. I don't know if it's happened yet, but please pray for the cousin. Please continue to pray for Jeff. Pray for Carl. How's Carl doing, Elizabeth? Any updates?
Awesome.
Okay.
He's pretty good.
Have you gotten to see him again or no?
No.
So please pray for Carl, pray for Marion and Rachel. Pray for Ginny, Bolton, and the guys. Please pray for all of those folks. Tish?
We have a praise. Our kids are all coming on the other side of the COVID.
Yes.
Now they need wisdom.
That, yes, a great measure of wisdom. Because they live in Mississippi. And that alone should tell you what that is. But I was talking to my daughter the other day. I said, now I suppose you're all going to be wearing masks. And a pregnant pause. I said, well, not necessarily, Dad. So I said, you're in Mississippi, child, so do whatever you have to do. But anyway, please pray for them. The good news is that they're all coming out to the other side and they're doing well. School's going to be reopening. Yay, everybody. I know it would be good for the young people to see their friends and family, their friends again. But pray for the administration of the schools and the staff, all the staff, from the school superintendent right down to the custodian who cleans the toilet, everybody in between. Pray for the children, that they'll have wisdom beyond their years. Pray for Laura in particular. She's been, I think, just about pulling her hair out, trying to get everything squared away over in Markerville, so pray for them. Continue to pray for the farm. The season is starting to wind down. I'm sure there's still a lot of work to do, but the season's winding down. Pray that that would go well. Pray for wisdom. Tish already mentioned it as far as our daughter. We all need a special measure of wisdom. We all do. And not just us. We need it as a church. We need it as a people. We need it in our elected officials. We need wisdom, but not wisdom that man would give, wisdom that God would give. And that we would also be smart enough to understand God's wisdom and how much different it is from ours. So pray about those things. There's one other thing. Normally we would say the Lord's Prayer at the end of the prayer. If Valerie was able to get it, I have a version of the Lord's Prayer music-wise that you can just think on as it's played at the end. So. Any other praises or prayer requests?
My daughter-in-law put something on Facebook the other day that just was such a blessing to me, and it was the stadium at Liberty University, the Flames Stadium, and it was full, absolutely full of young people praising the Lord and singing. It was just, I looked at that and I thought, oh Lord, that's wonderful.
Yeah, young people praising the Lord is always good.
Yes.
So. Well, why don't we go to the Lord?
I have a prayer request.
I'm sorry.
Did I have a prayer request?
Yes, Jody.
It's for my brother-in-law Mike, his father passed away this past week.
What was that, Jody?
It's Jody's brother-in-law Mike.
Yeah, his father passed
away. His father passed away last week.
Okay.
Is Katie back at school?
Yes.
Keep Katie in your prayers. And Jake and Hannah also is there, getting ready to go back, I guess.
Yep.
And pray for mom and dad that they keep their hair in their head while they're watching all their kids go all over. So, oh, the baby is home. Baby Gordy is home and doing well. I wish you could all see the pictures that we've seen of Dana with the baby. That girl is absolutely glowing. She is just so beautiful in the pictures we've seen. So just continue to pray for them. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I think about that song, the all-sufficient one, El Shaddai. God, you have provided for every need that we have, every desire that we have, every want. You're so sufficient. You're so good to each one of us, Lord. But I think about the other song also, this is my Father's world. Father, help us to remember and realize that you're in control. You know the beginning from the end. This is your world, Lord God. We've messed it up pretty good, but it's still your world. Father, help us to be better stewards of what you've given us. Father, I rejoice with those who rejoice this morning. I think of Charlie and Claire. I'm just so grateful that he's still doing as well as he is. I'm grateful for the word that we got this week that somebody told me that Charlie has accepted Christ as Savior. That is so good. I pray for the rest of his family, Lord, that they also would make the same commitment. Father, I thank you that Michelle and Mike and their family is on the other side of the COVID virus, and I pray for wisdom for them, Lord, that they would be smart enough to know what to do and how to do it. Father, I thank you for so many things, Lord. You are so good to us. You've blessed each one of us so very much. Father, I thank you for each person who is here this morning. I thank you for their faithfulness in coming, their faithfulness in giving, their faithfulness in being part of this little church. And Father, when I think about the people who are here, I think about those who aren't here. And Father, for whatever reason, I ask that you would minister to them today, that you would bless them, that you would encourage them, that you would draw them close to yourself, Lord. And Father, I pray that you would draw new people into the fellowship. People who have never heard about Jesus Christ. People who have never heard about salvation and the author of forgiveness, Lord. Father, I pray that you would bring people in. We can't do it, Lord, but you can. So I ask that you would do that. Father, I pray for those who need a touch emotionally this morning. Father, I pray for those who are in the nursing homes or rehab or can't get out, for Carl and Mary and Rachel and Ginny, Lord. I ask that you would touch them all in a special way, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Father, I pray for Jody's brother-in-law's father. Father, I pray that you would be with that family, you would encourage them and strengthen them, and that you would give them hope, even now when it may seem hopeless. Father, I pray about our schools that are reopening, from the colleges right down to the daycares, and everything in between, Lord. I pray that you would give wisdom and discernment, not just for the administrators, we pray for the administrators, the teachers, the staff, for their safety and well-being, but also for the students, Lord, that they would not be stupid. I know people don't like that word, but that's the only word that fits sometimes. Father, that they would be mindful of others around them. They would be mindful of just how easily spread this disease can be. And they would not think that they're impervious to it, Lord. But again, Father, that seems to be my overarching call for wisdom. Wisdom for them, wisdom for the school administrators. Wisdom as a church, Lord, and as a people. Especially at the church now, as we decide and we're thinking about what we do and how we do it, as we prepare for a board meeting in another week, Lord. Father, I pray that we would have wisdom, and you would give us a spirit of unity and unity of mind and spirit, Lord. Father, I pray as a people that we would have wisdom as we think about all that's happening around us and all that's still happening, and the fact that in a couple of months we've got an election coming up. I pray for wisdom. Father, I pray for our government. There are so many things that happen in our government we don't know about, but I pray there for wisdom also. Wisdom for our leaders. Father, that they definitely would have a sound mind. Father, I pray for peace in a peaceful situation. I think about all that's going on across the country now with the protest and even the riots, Lord. I pray for your peace that passes all understanding. Father, I pray that you would allow calmer heads to prevail and that this peaceful solution would be found. And honestly, Lord, as a pastor in a church, we know the real peaceful solution is when people come to Christ. Father, I pray that you would draw people to yourself even now. Father, I pray for our students. the ones that we know specifically, for Katie and Hannah, and for Jake, for Ariel, and Charlie's kids, for Eric and Melody, Lord God. Father, I pray for Mike and Andrew. Father, for Matthew. And Lord, I know I'm probably forgetting somebody, and I apologize if I am. I don't want anybody to be upset. But Father, I pray that you would watch over all our students as they head back to school. That you would give them safety, and that you would give them wisdom, Lord. And that this would be the best school year they've ever had, even in these difficult times. But Father, once again, I do thank you. I thank you, Lord God, because you are so good to us. You've blessed us more than any one of us has a right to be blessed. Father, help us realize that and help us just worship you in all that we say and do. And we'll give you the praise in Christ's name. Amen. Mm-hmm. Now just get this. Just listen to the song. It's a great song. The problem with this song was we couldn't just pull it off the web. We had to download it into the computer and then try to get it to work from there. And I know that because I did it with my computer at home. So. Just listen if you can't see. As I'm remembering the song, it doesn't sing the words. It just has the words on the screen, so. Just let it use this for a minute or two to say the Lord's Prayer in your mind, just to reflect on the Lord. Thank you. That thing is sounding like a motorcycle. If you were able to see the thing, it has thunder and lightning crashing. It says, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory." So anyway, I'm sorry about that. But you know, one thing I've learned through this virus and the pandemic we're going through, I've learned about how to do a lot more online and how to put a lot more on the computer. But at the other side, I've also learned not to get upset because the glitches are going to happen. So.
Can I see the praise and worship song work?
What's that?
You want to see the praise and worship song will work?
Yes.
Let's try it.
Valerie's got a praise and worship song, guys. So if you want to sing, please put your mask on. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations that do not know you will hasten to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to God, our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Father, I ask that you would take this word of yours, your holy, precious word to us, Lord. You would use it to encourage us, to strengthen us, and to build us up. And Father, as I say every week, if I don't say another word that makes any sense, your word would accomplish what you would have it do. I ask in Christ's name. Amen. Today I want to spend the time that we have together asking a common question. Very common. It's three letters. Matter of fact, it's the title of my sermon. Why? Why? Whether you're young or old, I'm sure that most, if not all of us, remember our mom or our dad telling us to do something. And after being told, we all ask the universal question, why? 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 You want to make an adult cry? And this is the younger people. If you want to make an adult cry, ask the adult why after every explanation he gives you about something. The sky is blue. Why? It's raining. Why? The snow is falling. Why? You can make an adult cry asking why so many times. But we do ask why. And when you do ask why, when you ask your parents, do you remember what the response was? The usual response was? At least if you grew up in my house?
Because
I said so. But as a child, is that or was that ever really enough? A strange thing has happened in today's society. I think too many young parents fail to realize that the all-around catch-all phrase is simply because. Or you maybe can add a couple of words onto it, because I said so. Instead, I've seen too many young parents spend so much time and so much effort trying to explain in detail why a child should do or not do something, when the reality is that simply put, because I said so was enough. I watched my daughter cry when her oldest one was younger, because she spent so much time trying to tell her, Mackenzie, do this, Mackenzie, do that. And this is why Mackenzie was 2 years old. She didn't care. But we spend so much time as parents. And as parents and grandparents and adults, just the simple fact that we've been alive longer than other people and exposed to many more things qualifies us to say because. Because. Now, I don't want you to get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with telling a child that if they cross the street against the traffic without looking, that they could become roadkill. There's nothing wrong with telling a child if they put their hand on a hot stove, they're going to be burned. Or if they take a fork and stick it in an electrical outlet, they're going to fry. There's nothing wrong with explaining that. But there are some things that kids do not need to know right now. For those things, the simplest solution is because I said so. But you know, it isn't just children who aren't satisfied. I find it's interesting that in society we've become so used to having every little thing explained. We want to know everything. We have asked the question why so often, and it carries not only just to our family situation, but to every aspect of our lives. Think about it. Because I said so. That can apply in business situation, in business employer-employee relations. It can apply in student-teacher or government and governor. We need to realize there are times when A, we don't need to know why, and B, we can't see the whole picture. And yet, as a people, we continue to ask why. Why? So as I was thinking about that, I was wondering if this tendency to ask why and not be satisfied, unless we have a detailed explanation, has to carry over into our walk with the Lord. If it hasn't carried over, has anyone ever asked God why? I know I have. More often than I want to admit. Just some of the common things you may have heard said, maybe you've said. God, why did you let this happen to me? Why didn't you intervene on my behalf? God, why didn't you tell me I shouldn't marry that person? Oh God, why didn't you get the right job for me? Or the one that we've all asked, why did my loved one have to die? Why? We all ask that question. And I think what probably frustrates us more than anything else is that on the surface, it doesn't seem that God is willing to go into an explanation and explain the why. Listen, it's understandable that we want to ask God why the bad, terrible things happen in our lives and the lives of others and even the world around us. But what I find amazing is that we've become so used to asking why that many of us even want to question when the good things happen. Even when the good things happen. Now, I don't know this for certain, but I wonder if that isn't what's happening somewhere between verses 1 and 7 in Isaiah and then 8 and 9. Because in verses 1 through 7, we find an offer of free drink and refreshment to all who come. Food and drink for the soul. We hear that God is ready to make an everlasting covenant. That he's about to pour upon us all the mercies and unfailing love that he promised to David. Yet I wonder if people then, even now, aren't asking the question why. Again, I know I've asked. I've asked God, why me, God? And this is the good stuff. Maybe you haven't done this, but I've asked God, why me? Why have you bestowed so much favor on me? I have wondered and I've seen myself as a sinner in need of salvation. I ask, why have you done this for me, God? Why? And why is this thing called salvation so simple and free? Have anybody else? I don't know if you ever asked those questions. I have. But I imagine there were those in Isaiah's time who must have asked these same questions. I think there may have been those who heard verses 6 and 7 in it and asked, why now, Lord? Why now? Why should I seek you now and not later? Why will you not always offer these mercies and love? Why do I really have to give up my former way of life, including my thoughts? And why, oh why, Lord, would you abundantly pardon me? I already said that I think these questions may have been swirling around in the heads and thoughts of those who heard the words and promises. And let me tell you why I think this. We definitely have verses 8 and 9 that I'll get to in a minute. But if you were to look at Psalm 94, verse 11, you would read, the Lord knows the thoughts of man. The Lord knows. If we really believe this, which, by the way, opens up another whole avenue of why we need to purge ourselves of evil thoughts, because if God knows our thoughts, we need to get rid of them. Then what we read in verses 8 and 9 would seem to be God answering the age-old question of why. I have to tell you, in case you did not pick up on this earlier, I'm a proponent of the simple because I said so school of answering. I'm a proponent of that. I still do it with my grandchildren. I really think in different words, God is really answering the question in the same manner and saying to the people, simply because I said so. Listen again as I reread verse 8. My thoughts are completely different from yours, and my ways far above, beyond anything you could imagine, declares the Lord. My thoughts are different from yours. My ways are above yours. I think sometimes we spend too much time trying to figure out the whys and wise rather than simply accepting the fact that God's thoughts are completely different than ours. God's thoughts are on a total different plane. What God does or doesn't do often makes no sense to us with our finite minds, and yet it makes perfect sense to God. Last week I spoke about getting rid of or banishing my evil thoughts. I said how often when somebody cuts me off and does something dumb, my first thought is for a rocket launcher in the car. Or a flamethrower. So I could take them out. Those are my thoughts. But God's thoughts are for the very soul of that person. Which is completely different than my thoughts. Peter records this thoughts of God, records this concerning God's thoughts about those who have yet to bow their knees before him. Peter writes in 2 Peter 3:9, he, the Lord, does not want anyone to perish. So he is giving everyone more time to repent. You see, that's God's ultimate goal, to see everyone come to that place of repentance, which unfortunately often differs from my response. I want to see a person vaporized. God wants to see him saved. I want to see the person have feel my rib. God wants to see him feel his love. And just to make sure that we really understand that his thoughts and ours are different, are in different levels, he says through Isaiah, just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Well, we're tempted to ask God why we need to remember that not only, when we're tempted to ask God why, we need to remember that not only are his thoughts worlds different from ours, but also do we not have the facts that God has. We have less than that, what God has. Earlier in Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 and 10, we can read this. I am God, I alone. I am God, and there is no one else like me. Only I can tell you what's going to happen, even before it happens. Everything I plan will come to pass, for I do whatever I wish. There are so many things that I love about God. I could go on and on, but one of the things that I really love is the fact that it really would be enough if he simply said, because. It's more than enough if he just simply said, because I said so. But you know what's really great about God? Usually he doesn't just say, because. Usually he doesn't. If we look at Scripture, we'll find many places where God really does answer our whys. But when God's answering our whys, I think part of our problem is twofold. First, we don't look far enough into the Scripture. Many of us play Bible bingo. You ever play Bible bingo? Oh, I wonder what God's got for me today. Jesus answered, no more of this. We play Bible bingo. We don't go far enough into the Word. We don't look far enough. Or, God's answers are too simple. God's answers are too simple for us. We want something in depth. We want details. We want it explained, you know, every jot and tittle. We want to know everything. When we want to ask why, I would hope that you take several scriptures to heart and hang on to them as an answer to why. I've already said the first one. It was in verse 8 of chapter 55. My ways are completely different from your ways, and my ways are far beyond anything we can imagine. Let's face it, God operates on a different plane. And I know this really doesn't pertain to the message, but it popped into my head yesterday when I was going over my notes. There was a movie sometime back, and it had Tom Cruise and Cameron Diaz in it. And he was a spy, and she was, you know, it was a whole long drawn-out movie. But in the movie, he's trying to get her to come along with him. And she was fighting. She's, with me, you're up here. Without me, you're down here. With God, we're up here. Without God, we're down here. That makes so much sense when we realize that God's ways, God's thoughts, his ideas are up here. Ours are down at the bottom. The second thing I want you to remember is God loves you. John 3:16, most of us can recite this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. And that's the reality. God really does love you. Sometimes reading John 3:16 might open up even more wise, but it should suffice as an explanation that he loves us. And God doesn't just love us a little bit. God's love is everlasting. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Or Peterson in his message says it like this, I've never quit loving you and never will. Expect love and more love. That's how much God loves us. Simply stated, God operates from a position of love. Wouldn't it be fantastic if we always operated from that same position? No more rocket launches, Jim. No more flamethrowers. But a position of love. Another thing we have to think of when we want to ask the question why is the fact that God has plans for us. Plans that are far and away better than anything we can hope for or even imagine. I wonder if we don't have a problem accepting this because we can only see with our finite, our temporal eyes. We cannot see the beginning, we cannot see the end. We can only see right here. And yet God can see what's ahead. His plans for us are better than any plans we might have for ourselves. You've heard me use this scripture before, Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They're plans for good and not disaster, to give you a future and a hope. Or from another translation, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And then finally, even when things seem to go wrong, God can and does take those things and use them for our good. Well, we want to question, Lord, why? Why did this happen? Why is that happening? What's going? Why is there a pandemic? I don't know. But when we think about this next verse, the next time something happens that we can't fathom, Romans 8:28. For we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and called according to his purpose. God can take a pandemic, he can take a death, he can take an illness, and he can work everything for his good. He doesn't often always have to tell us, but he gives us hints as why he does things. Now, these are just a few of the many scriptures that we can find when we're tempted to ask God the question why. But I would challenge you, the next time you want to ask God why, go to your Bible and search for reasons. God usually will tell us much more than because I said so, if we're willing to look and if we're willing to listen. But really, the truth is, if that was all God ever said to us, because I said so, that should be more than enough for every one of us, shouldn't it? I'm going to end there. I'm going to give you a little heads up. I still have at least two more sermons I want to go through from Isaiah 55. But there's been a verse that's been going through my head for a couple of weeks now. Since next week is communion, I'd like you to, this week, spend time in Proverbs 18. Specifically verse 10. And I want to preach on that next week because there's a song. The verse has been put into song. The song is, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. And that I've woken up with that in my head for a couple of weeks now. Almost every day. And I sing it during the day. I just feel the Lord wants me to share it with us. So I'm going to take a break from Isaiah. And next week we're going to look at Proverbs 18, verse 10. So let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you because you don't often say it just because I said so. You tell us you said it because you love us, you care about us. You tell us that we don't know what's coming down the road, but you do. And you're watching out for us and you're protecting us. But Lord, the reality is, if all you said was because I said so, we need to learn to trust you and listen to you so much that that's enough. That's enough, Lord. Help us to do that now, I ask in Christ's name. Amen. I think Val has our last song for us. If you want to sing again, please put your mask on.
Thank you.
Trust and obey. That's hard to do sometimes, isn't it? Especially when the only answers we seem to get is because I said so. But we have to learn to trust and obey. Trust and obey. Father, I ask that you would help each one of us this morning and throughout this week to truly trust and obey you. To listen to your word and listen to your voice, even when it just simply says, because. To trust and obey you, Lord. And Father, I ask that you'd be with us now as we prepare to leave this place. That you would watch over us, Lord God. That you would keep each and every person here in the center of your strong right hand. And that you would keep us until we come together again. And I ask that in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Have a blessed week.